We'll now call the 7 o'clock Outer County Commission meeting to order. We'll call on Mr. Johnson for the invocation.
Let's pray, please. Heavenly Father, we again approach your throne of grace, and Father, we just hope you'll remind us that we're in need of your wisdom, and we're in need of your grace and your mercy. And Father, help us never to forget that the decisions we make impact folks' everyday life. That Father, that we'll be a blessing to them and not a burden. That we'll make wise decisions that will please you and minister to the folks in this county. We ask it in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. Let us stand for Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Call on Mr. Messman for adjustments to the agenda.
Mr. Chair, I have a couple of adjustments to make to the agenda. Under administrative matters, we have one addition that will become item N. Item N, request to appropriate up to $70,000 from the contingency fund for additional repairs to the parking lot at the tax administration building. That would be budget amendment number 25. Under unfinished business, the item that was listed there for discussion has been deleted for discussion this evening. Under closed session, we'd like to add for closed session item to concerning personnel. That would be GS 143.318.11A6. Those are the adjustments to the agenda, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Massman. Are there any additions or corrections to the agenda? If not, do I have a motion to accept the agenda?
So moved.
It's been moved. Any questions regarding the motion?
Motion to approve as presented by the manager, Mr. Chair.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Appointments before the board, presentation of the company's annual financial report for fiscal year ended June 30th, 2008. Mrs. Blumenstein.
Thank you. Tonight we have with us Marcy Spivey and Amber McGinnis from our external auditing firm, Martin Starnes and Associates, and they'll be presenting their report. And along with Amber and Marcy is Deb Alford, Assistant Finance Director. She's been instrumental in pulling all the data together that the auditors use as documentation for our annual report. Glad to have her here.
I always like to start by thanking you for allowing us to continue to be your auditors. We've been here several years now, and it's really been a pleasure working with your group. Things have changed in the way that we audit. Once upon a time, we used to come out here, we'd be out here maybe 4 weeks out of a year, and it was at different times. And now through electronics and some improvements, we're able to, we still work year-round with all of your staff, but it's mainly through emails. And we come out and we do what's called interim, where we do a lot of your compliance work and work on DSS and other grants that you might have received. And then we come back again at final, and that's where we really pester the finance office, and we hang around all week long. But we have such good work partners here with your people in your finance office, with Deb and I'm sorry, I drew a blank all of a sudden. I got nervous. Deb and Susan work so hard, and they have everything ready for us. So we just we really appreciate that when we come out for an audit, and we get that kind of cooperation, not only from these two, but from the rest of the staff. Everyone seems to be well prepared and very willing to work hard for us and answer questions as fast as we can all go. What we're really here to do is talk about the financial report for June 30th, 2008. And I realize that you've probably had other finance meeting since then and talked about what things are since then, but this goes back to what we reported on and what you have your report on. Again, you received an unqualified opinion this year. That means that you have no material misstatements in these financial statements. So that kind of means the common reader should be able to open them and be able to read them without there being something misstated in there. Your general fund cash at June 30th was $42 million. The general fund revenues were $159 million, and the general fund expenditures were $153 million. Just like our checkbook at home, this is a good thing that the revenues were greater than your expenses. This general fund summary just shows you where you stood in the last 3 years. It shows you that for the past 3 years, your revenues have been greater than your expenditures. The increase over last year is about a 29% change. A lot of that is due, your expenses were down through your budget and efforts of your staff to keep your expenses low. This fund balance, we like to point out, you know, people talk about fund balance as if it's cash, and we always like to come back and say, now it's not just cash, it's all of your assets less your liabilities is what your fund balance is equal to. And your fund balance, on top of being a single number, it actually has three different types of fund balance. Your reserved fund balance is reserved by outside parties. Banks can put restrictions on the money that's loaned, so that would be reserved at year end. All the grants that you receive, like DSS and those other types of grants, those are all restricted for the purpose in which they were received. So they're not allowed to be spent on anything else, and they immediately become reserved if not spent by year end. We will talk a little bit more about your reserve, because although you have a nice fund balance, a lot of that is reserved already. The unreserved but designated are generally things approved by the board. The board is allowed to designate additional funds. So if you have planning for a capital project, planning for any capital outlay, that's also going to be reserved by this board or restricted by the board. And then you have the unreserved, undesignated, and that's really the remainder that hasn't already been spoken for. This is just a nice picture of your fund balance that lets you see how the changes are coming about. You did have a $5 million increase over the last year, and that was almost principally due to your tax revaluation and the revenues increased by that. This fund balance position is what I've been trying to talk back to. On this 2008, you'll see your total fund balance was over $52 million. But the required reservations, those things that have to be reserved, are already $25 million of that. So that brings it already down to that $26 million. And in that $26 million, part of that could be designated as well.
Didn't they change the we had to consider part of it designated due to something, employee retirement, or didn't that change a lot?
I believe that next year you will start reporting in your reports OPEB, which is other benefits.
Okay, so that starts next year, not this year.
Yeah,
okay.
And it was basically based on your size, but it was your size and, gosh, it's been years ago, but they didn't change the tiers, but the first tier that started reporting OPEB is in the current year. I believe you guys start next year, and it will be a big change in your report.
How much do we think that's going to impact it by? Do we know? Just ballpark.
About $2.6 million.
Okay, thanks.
This unreserved fund balance is a percent of expenditures. You see, this actually has gone down, and this is what we're talking about. Although your fund balance grew in the current year, your restrictions and reservations actually grew even larger, so your fund balance as a percent of expenditures actually went down. That 17% that just went by, that's actually about 2 months worth of spending that you have in your fund balance. We generally talk about the top three revenues. You have all kinds of revenues in there, but the top three, if you'll see, approximately 90% or 88% of your total revenue pie. Your property tax is making up 54%, sales tax is 23%, and your federal and state grants 11%. So when you think about what your real revenues are, that's really it. The other stuff becomes almost miscellaneous when you have such big chunks like that. your property tax. This is a picture of what changes when you have that reval. This property tax revenue went up about 19% over the prior year. And that also has something to say about your collection rate. You have one of the higher collection rates. You know, that's diligence on the part of your tax collection group, keeping after and making sure that the billings are done properly. And it also says something, actually says something about your citizens paying. The sales tax is an increase of approximately 3%. And that's basically just the sales in your area and what your normal amount is. So that's kind of a steady increase. The federal and state grants actually went up in the current year. The majority of this increase was due to a DSS administration reimbursement, which is based on, part of it is based on the number of people that are working in DSS. You actually had 11 additional people in the current year added to your payroll, so your allocation actually went up. What we'll see when we get to the expense side is that you actually had more expenses there as well, which pretty much, I won't say it's a wash, it was a little bit different, but what you got in, you actually had to put right back out. We'll do the same thing with your top three expenditures. You'll see that when we look at the whole pie, human services, public safety, education make up the majority of all that you had. It's actually 74% of the total. Which this is in keeping. If we had last year's slide, it would look almost exactly the same. And that's pretty common for a county, is that these are the main services over and over. Your education expense went up in the current year. You had an increase of approximately $8 million or 20%. This is, of course, you're getting a lot more in your allocation. So it goes right back to the schools. That's an increase of almost $8 million in your education expenses over the year. In human services, this goes back to the revenue that we just talked about. Your revenue increased, your human services costs increased as well. The 11 people added that brought up your revenues also take out expense. This public safety, a lot of that change had to do with positions in the, actually an increase in your inmate population. There are four more personnel is required at your jail. There were, I think, five positions added, but that's about a $2.5 million increase over the last year as well. Your solid waste disposal facility fund, your debt service costs were $1.2 million in the current year. And I looked because I knew that you had a lot of borrowing in the current year for your new solid waste facility. Next year, your payments will actually go up. Seems like at least another $100,000 or more. And then in the following year, you're actually going to go up again. And that's just if there's not additional borrowing. You can look at that when you have an opportunity to look at your reports. You will see the debt service is in there, and if you look at the enterprise fund debt, you'll be able to see that has changed a lot. You added at least about $10 million in the current year in the debt for that solid waste facility. One of the things I did want to mention in your report, you will notice that there are two reports where last year everything was in one. Part of that change has to do with all the new SASs and compliance rules and regulations. We have given everyone an opportunity to put their compliance in a separate binding because it's just, it's actually bigger than it had been previously. One of the other things, and it's not necessarily happening for this county, you guys do a really good job, but if there are findings where previously we might have talked to the board or just talked to Susan anymore, those are just really not allowed. If we have something that needs to be reported, it's going to show up in a bound report in your hands. I won't, for this county, I don't think that's such a big deal. You've always been presented in that way. But again, there's going to be a separate report now. Also, in your report that you're currently holding, there's a section up front, the management discussion and analysis. That's a really good place to get current year information. It talks about what happened. And then it also has a good section in the back that talks about your planning for next year, and it talks about your budget and what you're expecting to see happen next year. Do you have any questions that I might answer on this?
Member, thanks for coming.
Thank you very much.
Mrs. Blumstein, do you have any comments? Or?
I appreciate the work they've done and the finance department and all the departments because of them we're successful and they're all very diligent in their documentation and complying with the laws and general statutes and rules that we have to meet each year. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Smith, you're next. Thanks, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, Board of Commissioners. We have a rezoning request in front of us tonight from Perth Landscaping and Supply, who is represented by Robbi, Grayson. This is a piece of property that's located on Perth Road, and it's a little over 4 acres, and the request is to go from RA, residential agriculture, to CBCD, and that's community business conditional or conditional district. Sorry, that's a mouthful. This is a case that you've seen before, or a piece of property that you've seen before, was studied in our Perth study, and I'll get to that a little bit later. The zoning history on this, last year there was a request from not Ms. Grayson but Mr. Odell Stamey to rezone the property to highway business, which was turned down by a vote of 3-2. This had come up a couple of times with the planning board and then with the commissioners and finally was voted down by a 3-2 vote. It is located in the watershed, so in dealing with this, as well as zoning, we're also dealing with impervious coverage as well, and I think that may be discussed somewhat tonight, but the site plan and the existing facility is in compliance with the watershed. Perth Road, a lot of talk about the traffic on Perth Road. As of 2006, and this is the latest traffic counts we could get, there were 8,900 trips per day, and the capacity on Perth is 13,800. Now, that's significant in that when we made our recommendations through the small area plan, traffic was a pretty primary concern, and truck traffic in particular on this particular piece of property was of concern as well. When we submitted the rezoning request to our other agencies, schools, fire marshal, and EMS, we only got comments back from one, which is actually fairly uncommon, but the fire marshal did say that straw and pine needles could not be located inside a building, to which Ms. Grayson has agreed that would not be the case. So you'll find that in your package as well. As you can see on the map here, that this is a copy of our an excerpt from our land use plan, which has incorporated our Perth Road study, which we completed early this year. There is no commercial development or commercial node located in this particular area. Again, the facility is already there and does have a long history. Back in, I believe it was 2003, it was permitted as a farm-type enterprise. And later, the zoning ordinance was changed to essentially take this piece out or not make it qualify as a farm-type enterprise. And now we're dealing with this as a non-conforming use. And tonight, if it is rezoned, we're calling it a commercial nursery. So the point being that it is a non-conforming business that predates the plan, predates the amendment to the ordinance, but does not really qualify now for any expansion of significance without either getting a rezoning or coming before the planning board and this board for an expansion of a non-conforming use. If they go through with the expansion request, it's fairly limiting. I'll use this plan. This is the existing plan. This is what we've been working off of for the last couple of years. This was the site plan that was approved when the facility originally started going. If Ms. Grayson were to go through with an expansion of a nonconforming use, the flexibility would not be there as it would be if it's rezoned. The only thing on the property that could be expanded under the nonconforming would be the building. As with many nurseries and greenhouses and establishments of that nature, there's a lot of use of the open land as well. And in this case, Ms. Grayson wants to put in an arboretum, a nursery for potted trees and plants, and she'll be able to explain this better than I can, and some improvements on the site and to the parking areas and storage areas that would not be allowed under the nonconforming expansion. So that's one of the main reasons that she's come before you tonight for the rezoning request. Again, this is the original plan that we've been working off of for the last several years. You'll see some significant changes between this plan and the one that Ms. Grayson is proposing. There is a proposed truck entrance on the northern side of the property, an additional building additional greenhouse that would be in addition to the existing building, an expansion of the parking and storage area, again, the arboretum, which would be allowed under our current standards, but just has not taken place, and then the nursery area. This lighting is awful on this picture, but this is the gravel drive going back to the neighborhood on the north side of the property, on the north side of the facility. This is the fence line looking south down Perth Road. This goes back up into the neighborhood. This is just a view of the property, front of the building. This is looking north. This is the southernmost part of the building, and these are not that current pictures. I don't think the mulch is still there, but this is a mulch storage area that is spread around on the property. Looking to the east, and to the east meaning to the back side of the property. Leland cypresses are right here, but there are houses that overlook the site. This is looking south again. This is Knotty Pine right here, where there was an access at one point, which has been closed off. Again, looking south, and this is Knotty Pine and Perth Road. Again, looking south. This is the ditch line and the front fence of the property across the street. Across the street is Honeysuckle Creek. But a relatively new neighborhood on Perth Road, one way in, one way out. And again, the same neighborhood. And looking up from the south. Sorry, we got so many pictures tonight. This is a piece of property we struggled with through the Perth study. This was the only real significant commercial area other than going north and getting to the Skippers and Morningstar storage area. Because of its long history, we really had to decide, you know, do we designate a node on this tract, or do we not designate a node on this tract? We weighed it out and finally decided that we did not want to cause any more traffic, I won't say problems, but impede traffic at all along Perth, because that was one of the main issues that we dealt with through the study, and felt that by designating the node, we are essentially condoning the expansion of the business, which could then expand and cause more traffic. The significant issue, and I think Ms. Grayson can address this, is truck traffic on Perth Road. The access right now is not the best for trucks to get in, particularly in and out. And based on that, we have recommended, the staff recommended that a node not be included in the plan, and we're therefore also against the rezoning as well. The planning board has also heard this, had a lot of discussion about it, and was also against the and recommended denial by a vote of 11-0. and I'd be glad to answer any questions that you have. We have had quite a bit of conversation about this, including a neighborhood meeting and the planning board meeting, and Ms. Grayson could probably give you a little bit more detail than I have about the specific request.
Any questions, Mr. Mayor? Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Ms. Grayson, would you like to come up at this time?
For each of you, a copy of the PowerPoint and a petition that I've got two of signatures. Hello, and thank you so much for your consideration, your time, your attention. It's good to finally be here. I've been working on this for over a year now, so hopefully I'll be able to answer any of your questions, and hopefully I'll get your blessings at the end of this evening. I'll be going over the entire proposal, but before I do, I would like to make a few points. As you know, the Planning Board did not recommend this rezoning primarily because it was not in compliance with the Perth Small Area Plan. I understand land planning is accomplished by using well-thought-out guidelines such as the Perth Small Area Plan. However, Lake Norman Gardens wasn't in existence before the draft of the plan. I am not asking for a change in the nature of the business use. I am just requesting the right to use all my land with reasonable setbacks. Second, as you are aware, I'm requesting conditional business community district zoning. I'm reading. I believe this application is the perfect example of why you approve this type of zoning. I hope that after you review my request, you'll agree that this is an improvement for the Perth Road community. The proposed improvements will be a second entrance on the north side. Most of this, Ron, has gone over with you, but a second entrance on the north side of the property to safely move large trucks and trailers off Perth Road, eliminating current safety concerns. The addition of a climate-controlled greenhouse, and I'm going to go on to the next slide and point these out on the map itself. So let's see. Here is, and I'm shaking. I can't do this very well. Here is the proposed north entrance that will safely get large tractor trailers and personal trailers on the backs of trucks and cars off of Perth Road in a much safer fashion. We're going to have the addition of a climate-controlled greenhouse, nurseryman structure adjacent to the current structure. And as I go through, I will take each proposal isolated and explain to you why I would like to the need for these items on the proposal. There will be an installation of a water cistern, a water reclamation system for conservation and the control of runoff off from the upper lying areas to the lower areas. I'll go over that with you as well. We are on a wonderful hill, and there's a lot of opportunity to reclaim water there as opposed to using our well system that we're using now. I would like to add an arboretum in the lower southwest corner of the property. This would be a park-like arboretum. I'll share a little more with you about that. There would be a tree nursery in the lower southeast corner. We do not grow. We are not growers. We are a retail nursery, and the 98% of our trees and plants come to us in containers. So to stabilize and irrigate these trees in a fashion to prevent spoilage, we'd like to add a tree nursery in the lower southeast corner. And also the addition of bulk cribs to better maintain those materials, clean up the appearance of it. They're very unsightly. So that's just in a nutshell the list of improvements. First, I'd like to address the new entrance on the north side. This is our current entrance, and there's one way in and one way out. When tractor-trailer trucks come into our property, they typically have to make the right or left in, straddle Honeysuckle Creek Loop, meaning straddle Perth Road, in order to make the radius to come back to our loading docks. What I am proposing, which we looked at on this upper slide, is we will have a 30-foot setback. So that original drive that exists now that Ron showed you in the picture will be part of that 30-foot setback. Then we will add a new asphalt drive, and Wilma Price, who's not here with us tonight, is in favor of this. She's been a great neighbor, and she's asked for some conditions, and we have met those in trying to be a good neighbor as well. But the trucks will be able to come in the turning radius to take them to the back of the building, behind the building. There's ample turnaround on the parking area there, and the little bays represent the cribs for a truck to then come back out in that same direction and exit back on Perth Road, as opposed to coming through a parking lot with pedestrians, children. It's not uncommon that some of the mothers across the street come with their wagons and walk across the street and bring their children. So it's a much safer entrance and exit to the center as it currently stands. And we're concerned that one day a car is going to come over that hill blind and a truck's going to be there, and it won't be very pretty. I actually have a driver from Reiner, Virginia, one of my perennial growers, who likes to call before he comes. He keeps trying to get me to have a highway patrolman come out there. So it is a concern, and even with these truck drivers. Plus, our patrons have trailers behind their car. They come and get bulk mulch or pine straw and that sort of thing as well. So that is our proposed entrance. It would, as I said, have a 30-foot undisturbed buffer, continued access for Ms. Price's property on a newly paved road, generous opening with safe circulation. It is approved by DOT. I have met with Patrick and have their blessings. The other thing we're going to do with the delivery and the tractor trailers is we are proposing a condition to this zoning, and that is that our deliveries be limited to the hours of 9 and 3. So we'll have no delivery trucks prior to 9 and after 3. And that's mainly because there's a bus stop across the road, and we've had no challenges from any of our vendors with that request. And there will be signage before you make the right into our drive on the east side of the property going into Ms. Price's Road that states no prohibiting vehicles beyond that point so that they won't go up into her area. The next request on the proposal is a greenhouse that would be connected to the existing structure. Our existing building is not a greenhouse or a building that we can house living material in. The HVA system, it's just not made for that. We need a greenhouse that we can prevent spoilage. Right now, we have freeze cloths on everything. It damages our plants. And obviously, we go through our businesses cyclical, so winter we don't sell as much plant material, but we'd like to not lose all the plant material that we're left in because of our lack of being able to store it properly. This is the kind of structure that we're talking about. It's a very attractive structure. It is a permanent greenhouse. It's not a plastic shed or a temporary situation. And we would also be able to have our irrigation, and hopefully my goal is to have the drains in the greenhouse then reclaim that water back into our cistern. So this is primarily from my standpoint for spoilage and to better protect our plant material. Oops, I'm getting ahead of myself. The next part of my proposal, which I'm excited about, and particularly after last year's drought, is to add a cistern. There are now several companies in the Carolinas, and Catawba Valley Community College has now put in one, but a type of cistern that catches rainwater. A 2,000 square foot roof collects 1,200 gallons of water with 1 inch of rain. Our primary building has 6,000 square feet of roof space on it. The greenhouse would be another 2,400 square feet. One of the things that Patrick was great about, and we talked about this with DOT, is obviously from my fence to the center of the road is owned by DOT. But he said, you have my blessings, because if you stand on a rainy day and see the water that runs down the ditch on Perth Road, that we could even pipe that water into our cistern. I'm not sure my blue skies for the cistern to be located under the turnaround area in the crib space. That's blue sky. It might be a freestanding cistern, but it would not affect the watershed or any of the requirements that we've had to pay attention to with this project. So, and that, of course, well, we are currently on a well, and will keep us from tapping into that vein, which I think a lot of the neighbors are a part of that, too. This is just a picture of the cisterns, and this is I want to put a 5,000-gallon cistern in. So this is a company out of High Point, and this is one they actually put underground with baffles, and I think it'd be a great educational opportunity for the community, too, to be able to see this kind of forward-thinking with like I said, with our current drought situation that we just lived through. Man, I've opened a garden center the wrong time of the drought, the economy. But anyway, you have to laugh about it. The next part of the expansion would include this arboretum, and this is something I'm very passionate about. It would obviously be an enhancement to our business if people could come in and see the product planted in the ground, but it would also be an incredible enhancement to the community. This would be a park-like arboretum. I would like to plant all of the plants on the North Carolina Landscape and Nurseryman Association's plant list. So each plant would be identified, the collections, be it holly or azaleas or whatever. There's about 277 plants on this list, perennials. Everything would be identified, so our young people that are studying to go into the nursery and agriculture business could come and study for their certified plant professional exam. It would be a place where somebody could just bring their lunch and sit and relax and have it, enjoy their lunch. I would like to, I'm investigating now the possibility of also putting a rain garden in the arboretum. The rain garden would be something great in a lot of municipalities are adding them in watershed areas. I don't know if you're familiar with rain gardens, but you put native plants in and it encourages the water to go down into the ground as opposed to running off. And of course, with runoff being a concern, the arboretum would help prevent erosion. So it'd just be a great, you know, it'd be just the neatest thing in the whole wide world to be able to build this and see it mature and what it would offer to the Perth Road area. I jokingly say I want it to be beautiful enough that people will want to get married in it, but I'm not going to go there. I don't like to be late open at night either. So the arboretum would be our next part of the improvements. And then the tree nursery that I talked to you about in the lower southeast corner, it's basically a very simple system where you take 4x4s, stake them every 10 feet. There are guide wires that are hooked together, and as you see, these trees stand up against the guide wires, and then they make a little Velcro collar that it hooks on the wire and holds the tree upright. Days like today, when the wind is gusting like it is, we just have to lay all of our trees down because they won't stand up. And so this keeps the plant upright. And then we have little drip irrigation that would go into that, irrigate them in the middle of the night, the best time to water, using less water. And again, we'd be able to, this would actually become a savings for the garden center, which would be a savings for the community. You pass that on to the consumer. So our plant spoilage with our current conditions is much higher than the average garden centers. So that's our tree nursery. And raised board, we've also proposed raised, talking about watershed, boardwalk pathways through the nursery so that those areas would not be impervious. And then the bulk product cribs would first of all be concealed by an attractive berm along Perth Road, and that berm would have a pathway that would take you into the arboretum, or you could either come from the other side. There would be less waste. We now have to mix the last part of any pile becomes a part of the earth. I mean, it's so these would be, oops, sorry, and put my hands down. These would be in contained concrete containers, and obviously an easier access for our suppliers and our customers in this with this cribbed area. Just in closing, actually didn't follow my notes, so I'm... In closing, I think it is important to emphasize that we are a community business. We have three full-time employees. I have two part-time employees. My sales and use tax has over tripled since the year that I came and took over the Garden Center, which has added revenues for the county. We participate with local church, preschools, and Girl Scouts. We have held a fundraiser for Dove House. We are participating this middle of December with the United Way, decorating part of the Sharp House for their tea party. So we are a big part of the Perth Road and the Iredell County community, and I'm very proud of that. I look at the Garden Center as being truly a community business, and you can argue traffic on Perth Road, and it is amazing how much there is a lot of traffic, but you can also argue that while we're keeping people from more congested areas by coming to the Garden Center for things that they need. So people need the plant material and the products that we sell. We also are a big informational source for the community of Perth Road. As you know, so many people are not from Iredell County, North Carolina. Probably not one in two people that walk through our door not, and they don't know the plants that grow. So we are a great source of information about, you know, what you do with that red clay.
Ms. Grayson, you got about a half a minute to wrap
it
up.
Okay, I'm wrapping it up. There is a clear consensus among a large group of neighbors and residents of Iredell County that this rezoning and the improvements that are to come are preferable to the existing situation. Regarding our opposition, I'd like to address two points. Assuming the same slides are shown this evening that were shown at the planning board meeting, I request that slides that are two or more years old be identified as such. Also, there is a lot of controversy about the ditch on the southwest corner that belongs to the DOT. Patrick Norman has said that we could clean it up. However, they don't have the money to do it, and he has no issue with us cleaning up. You will see a slide of one of my dump trucks stuck beside that ditch, and I would like to tell you what that slide's about. And if I can just do this very, very fast. Couples walking down the beach, they're arguing. A cute puppy comes by, and somebody takes a picture of that couple. It looks like they're having a great day because they smile at that puppy. I had a new employee, and my son was at my new home clearing some brush out of the back of my house. Scooter brought from Nashville, Tennessee. Scooter brought a load of mulch to my house, picked up the debris. I told him to dump it in the lower southwest corner. I'm trying to do this fast. And he came in. It was a very busy Saturday. Chuck McCurdy, who was working for us, said, Scooter told him where he was putting it. Chuck said, no, Scooter, don't put it there. He said, no, that's where she told me. Before Chuck turned around, he was down there. Nothing was dumped. The truck got stuck up. It cost us $200 to tow it. But it was a total miscommunication. The kid just went to the wrong place. Other than that, I have not dumped in that corner and would like to see it cleaned up. Thank you.
Thank you. Any questions for Ms. Grayson before she leaves?
We've got a couple. I was one of the ones who had some issues with the last time y'all came forward. The trucks pulling in and out of Perth Road, do the changes, I'm talking about the supply trucks, not, you know, Joe in a pickup truck pulling a trailer to pick up mulch or trees or whatever. But what is your daily truck volume as far as large tractor, you know, large vehicles making deliveries, and do you see that number changing on a daily basis, the number of big trucks coming in and out?
The number varies depending on the time of the year, obviously. So let's talk about the maximum, which is sure. Would be our springtime. And I can have two trucks a day that time of year. My theory is that if I have more area to store plants, because plant trucks, for example, come, a tractor trailer may have four nurseries. Items on, and they put a screen, and they drive from nursery to nursery. Well, if I can buy twice as much, then I'm eliminating the number of deliveries. In other words, if I have storage for more plant material, then I would have two deliveries a month as opposed to one every week. So, in terms of the number,
so you're not getting big deliveries like that every day.
Okay.
All right. Next question was: you said you're trying to control the times between 9 and 3. I mean, these drivers don't work for you. They're your suppliers. How are you able to get them to control those times, and are you doing that now?
I am, and my experience is that I'm the customer for these suppliers. I have talked to every one of my major suppliers, plant vendors, the suppliers that drive these large trucks. They are very supportive of what we're trying to do, and there has been no issues. We have one driver that comes from Louisiana, one truck that comes from Louisiana about probably 4 to 6 times a year, and he always wants to be there at 8 o'clock. You know, he must drive all night, and we're his first stop. And since I have now met with Ms. Price and we've talked about some of the conditions, he has done a delivery and he had no problems. We just tell him, you know, you've got to pull over somewhere else and wait till we're there at 9 o'clock. So I've had no problems with that.
Okay, good. The bends, you said that 5-foot berm is going to obstruct the view of the bends from the highway. Does the berm just go up to the level of the bin, or does it exceed the level?
And it would go to the back of the concrete surface of the bin itself, yeah.
Okay, so somebody just driving by Perth Road, they glance over their shoulder or whatever, they would not see concrete bins?
Correct.
They're going to see a berm.
Okay. Correct.
Just out of curiosity, have you any idea how much of your business is coming from off of the Perth Road area? I mean, what one of the issues is, you know, how much traffic? Do you think that you're getting a lot of business from the other side of I-77, or do you think that yours is really pretty much a community Troutman to, you know, maybe up 150 a little bit?
Statesville, Troutman, 150. We do get folks from Denver, Sherrill's Ford, and we get some folks from Raleigh School. I mean, we have that. Raleigh School is a, you know, I mean, if you think of a true garden center and not a quote-unquote big box,
right?
We're the closest garden center to the Raleigh School, 150, Troutman, Statesville area, until you get to Huntersville or Cornelius, I think. So.
Okay, and the greenhouse, you showed the picture, but is that part of the conditional use? I mean, it's they couldn't. And I guess I'm asking my question to Ron Smith, but you're up there. I mean, so far, everything that you've done, just the changes I've seen, indicate you wouldn't do this. But, you know, let's just say she was Mrs. Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. I mean, she couldn't put up a wood frame and just staple plastic up and call it a greenhouse, correct?
Are you asking if it's rezoned?
Could she rezone it? If we rezone it, she couldn't change her mind and just put up a wood frame and staple plastic. And Ms. Grayson, just so you know, there's nothing that you've done so far that makes me believe that is even remotely your intention. But I got to ask the question.
Probably she could. You could state, if you're so inclined, you could state in a motion or through this process that she could not do that. But I don't think we specifically talked about materials or building materials on the building. It's mainly just size and location. So she could definitely build something that size as shown or smaller, but could not go larger. And the materials we don't control.
Okay. And I observed on the photograph, outside of your fence line, outside of your fence, and I got to know the question of this. It looks a whole lot different than it did a while back. Are you the one who's maintaining and planting the grass and all that kind of good stuff between your fence and the road?
Yes, I am.
It does look a lot better. Okay, thank you.
Sure. Any additional questions? Okay, thank you, Ms. Grace. We will now hear comments from the public. Anyone wishing to speak in favor or against the request, if you will come over here next to the stand. When you come to stand, please state your name. And what are you
for or against this request? If you want to come forward, sir, come on forward. You have 3 minutes to speak.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Appreciate the opportunity to speak. My name's Jack Davis. I live on Knotty Pine Lane. I appreciate Ms. Grayson's intentions, and I'm not against her having a business. It's just I'm against her having her business in my neighborhood. This piece of property really involves four parcels, and two of them are in a registered subdivision, which is my neighborhood. This, for me, has been going on nearly 6 years. We've started complaining to the county as a neighborhood 5 years ago. And through all those complaints and in-person visits to the county, if you investigate, I don't think you'll find any of it on paper. Because I even had people take me in their office and say, yes, here's the form you can fill out and get it on paper, but I'll fill it out for you. This has gone on for 5 years. There's been no enforcement of the zoning on this property. There are multiple zoning ordinances that have persisted for 5 years. There are multiple watershed ordinances, multiple subdivision ordinances, and sign ordinances. Could I give you these pictures to circulate? They range from 5 years ago to current. Now, the only warning I know of that the county gave this business was about storing mulch on the southwest corner of the property. And that mulch was moved to come in conformance. And now that mulch is there again. It was mentioned tonight by Mr. Smith that it's probably not there. But I guess Mr. Smith or the county never goes down Perth Road. Last meeting, Rebecca Harper mentioned that the business is in compliance because no one complained about it. Well, what I learned from that is if we don't complain, then the county will not enforce. Mr. Warren was nice enough to come out in the newspaper and say, we're not interested in making money off of fines. We don't benefit from a long, protracted battle that could end up in court. Now, that's a free pass for this property owner to help themselves violate any ordinances they want to, and there will be no enforcement. And there has been no enforcement for 5 years here. There's a neighborhood across the street that supports this property. And if this business was across the street in their neighborhood, then I think my neighborhood would support it. My neighborhood has been totally disregarded in this situation. Pictures were shown tonight of this property.
This is my neighborhood over here. There was not one picture shown of my neighborhood. My neighborhood is being totally disregarded in this situation.
If you return to the mic so we can pick you up.
I think, this is my opinion, I don't want anybody to take it as fact, but I think that there is a hidden effort here to help the property owner. It's outlined in these newspaper articles that the county cannot enforce against this property owner. The county doesn't want to end up fining or being in court, and so it feels like the answer is to give the zoning changes that the property owner has forced upon us. And to be honest with you, whether you vote this in or not really doesn't seem to make any difference because there's been no enforcement of the zoning for 5 years. I think it kind of makes all this a moot point. But I feel like it'd be very reckless for you to vote this change in because I, as an amateur, can look through the county's website and the zoning and see the endless violations, and I can see that it would be easy to challenge it if this zoning change was made. But I want to take this opportunity to say, regardless of how you vote, I am very disappointed with the enforcement, and I don't really expect any improvements one way or the other, because this property owner has been given a free pass, as it was put in the newspaper. And I know that there's enforcement on other people in that area. It seems to me like this is the only property in Outerdale County that does not have to conform to the zoning ordinances. Thank you for the opportunity.
Okay. Next person, please.
Hi, my name is David Turner, and I'm here tonight to speak against the rezoning of this property. I'd like to clarify a few facts that were actually misstated earlier. The planning board said this was a piece of commercial property, the one they were looking at. It is not. It is a legal, non-conforming residential agricultural property that's grandfathered in. It is not commercial. It has never been commercial. So I want to clarify that. Number two, as we talk about things, and Mr. Robertson addressed an issue, Ms. Grayson is a registered agent of this company. She is not the property owner. She has no deed in her name. If she does, I would love to see it produced. But I did check with the Secretary of State on this. A couple other things that do go wrong with this property. When this did come up last time, it was voted 3-2 to rezone this property, which the only thing I could come with was maybe they were trying to help a property owner. But the problem is, as you want to make something community business, we open the door for so many different things. If we'd like to go through the list of the 18 other things community business can be, and I would like to say convenience store, gas station, 10,000 candlelights, you want traffic. We've all got a traffic study that, unfortunately, the planning board, I'm sorry to be railing on you, but from 2006, that is very inaccurate. Perth Road has grown by over 40% since probably that study has been done. So that is a very inaccurate traffic study right now. We all know what's going to be coming down with the county commissioners on Perth Road, just as the planning board has said, widening of it to four lanes. There is perfectly prime commercial locations a little further north and actually a little more to the southeast that could be used for a business she is describing. This is residential agriculture. She is in there, legal, non-conforming, but making her a community business, like I said, this is not about making her community business. This is about you as the board spot zoning a property that can then be sold to someone else and they can do whatever they want. If you want a gas station there, we want to have, like I said, a convenience store, an office building, all perfectly legal.
Mr. Turner, you got 30 seconds.
Under those conditions. I would ask the board to look at this and advise them that spot zoning is illegal in the state of North Carolina. I did check with the Attorney General on that. And I would like you to know, if it does come to that, I'm sure there will be voters that will come to pass and say this was the wrong thing that we did and we need to make changes. So please remember, spot zoning is illegal in the state of North Carolina, and this would be a prime example of that. Thank you.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners. My name is Lance Demaray, and I am a resident at Honeysuckle Creek Loop across the street. And I'd like to start, if I could, at the risk of sounding like I'm pandering, but I'd like to offer my congratulations to Mr. Robertson and Mr. Williams on their re-election, the recent re-election. So with that, I am a neighbor of Robbi Grayson and the folks over at Lake Norman Gardens. When I look at the situation, there's two ways I've come to my conclusion to put my support behind what Lake Norman Gardens is doing. First, when I looked at the plan, I looked at this pragmatically, looking at the opposition. I went to a meeting at Knotty Pine that they held where they discussed all their objections, and then also went to Robbie's meeting and attended, and she went through the plan that she had. And when I look at it, I only see a situation that is going to improve. I think Robbie's looking through the windshield, and some of the folks are looking through the rearview mirror. And I think that although they have some good objections and arguably some things that have happened in the past before I got here, I don't know all about. So I do, put my I don't know a lot of the stuff that's happened in the past, but all I can look at is where I'm at today, and I've been a resident for 2 years. So pragmatically, as I look at it, I think it only improves the area, improves the situation that we have today. And then looking at it at a personal level, I'm not only a patron of Lake Norman Gardens, but we have a neighborhood association in Honeysuckle Creek that we started, and Robbie's been very, very supportive in helping us with certain landscaping projects that we've tried to tackle with some sweat equity, just a number of neighbors coming together. She's given us manpower, equipment, and know-how or expertise that we just don't have. So she's volunteered those things. So I think she's a very good member as a business neighbor and a member of the community. So I think for that reason, we should support her and what she's trying to do. I think she's those are the type of business people that we should be supporting and helping her do the things that she wants to do over there. And I think it'll only improve the situation. So thank you for your time. I appreciate it. And have a good evening. Thank you.
Good evening, all. My name is Steve Carboneau. I'm a resident of the Honeysuckle Creek Loop development. I've been a resident of North Carolina and that specific housing development now for 2 years. And, you know, I second everything that Lance Demaray had said. I cannot speak to exactly what has occurred with this property prior to the 2 years I've been a resident of this neighborhood. But I will say that Robbi has been completely forthcoming with all the information. She made it a sincere effort to go out to the local developments, get people to come into her building, to her establishment, lay out all the plans in terms of what she wanted to do with the property. It was certainly an open forum in terms of communication where all residents could ask questions, and they certainly had their opportunity where she would respond. She even, you know, offered that if there were people in the neighborhood that had questions, that they could come in at any time and address them, that she's willing to work with us. My biggest concern was beautification of the property, you know, adding value to the local area in terms of drawing additional homeowners into the area. Without question, I think her plans are going to do that. It's certainly an improvement over what she has now, and there's nothing wrong with what you have now, Robbi. But I commend her effort in trying to grow her business. As a small business owner in this economy, she needs to take steps to do so. It's tough times out there, and we want her to prosper and grow there. My other main concern was the traffic. You know, we have kids, a lot of kids in our neighborhood, and I think specifically in terms of the plan that they have of widening the road on the side is far better than what they have now where trucks coming in the main entrance. So from a safety concern, I think what we're looking at moving forward is definitely better than what we have. And to Robbie's comments about changing the scheduling of the trucks, I've been in business for a number of years servicing customers, actually in the lawn and garden business, although I have nothing to do with Robbie's business. And she is correct. Those providers, those nurseries, she is the customer. As in my business, we service customers, and they're going to do what she asks. I have no doubt about that.
Mr. Carboneau, you are out of time, sir.
Okay. Other than that, I look forward to the approval and the improvements that she's going to make on the property. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good evening. I'll keep mine very brief. My name is Brian Nelson. I also live in Honeysuckle Creek development across Perth Road from the established business we're discussing. And I just want to, I know we've talked about a lot in the past. We've been to several meetings and we continuously hear about 5 or 6 years ago. I'm sure some more people would bring that up. I likewise have only lived in North Carolina a short period of time. I like to see that dramatic improvement in the property. I think the plan's in place. It's the right thing to do. Tough economic environment, and she is really swinging for the fences here to try to make that dramatic improvement. I'm certainly not knocking the business how it is now, but to look across the road or drive up Perth Road to see a new establishment there versus what there is currently, I would openly welcome that, and I think a lot of my other neighbors who were not participating tonight in the discussions would second that opinion. Lastly, I think Mr. Robertson, you mentioned about trying to pull traffic. That where those customers come from, I think a large number of those people are coming from our corridor, our side of 77. Difficult to do. I work for a large home improvement organization and trying to do those zip code analysis and surveys. It's tough to do. So I do second what my other two neighbors have said and look forward to your decision on this and approval. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Tom Knoll. I'm one of the three current full-time employees that work for Ms. Grayson here. I am in full support, of course, for Ms. Grayson and the zoning. Again, I have to agree with this gentleman said. I'm not trying to knock our business, but as you do drive down the road, you do see an empty dust pit. It's red clay. That's what North Carolina has. And to still have that and not get approved for this zoning, to still have that versus a nice, clean, paved drive, where cribs are, nicely neat. We'll have a beautiful arboretum instead of random mulch piles, things of that. It's just very aesthetic to the eye, something very pleasing. She works, she's, like he said again, she swings for the fences. She tries to hit a home run every time. She's very, very hardworking, and I have the most respect for her. But I just want to say I hope that you guys approve this because it would definitely give me a lot more work, especially this bad economy. And I think it'd just be beneficial to the whole entire community. But thank you for your time.
I'm Russell Smith. I live in Statesville here, near Barham Springs. And I haven't been here too long in this area. But I really appreciate the garden center there. I've been going there now for close to a year and a half now, as long as I've been here. And I know she's made improvements just about every time I've been there. I think really it's every good neighborhood should have an area like this. Let's face it. Most people, you know, the land is blank. And those that want to keep their gardens, their yards clean, to put up trees up, flowers, then this is the place they go. So now she's the only one I know in our area there. Where would we go? And it seems to me like she's made arrangements here, from what I've heard, to correct any problems that you gentlemen here and ladies might be against. And I think that we're in a time now where we need to look for progress. And not. And I think this is progress. That's a nice neighborhood, big fine homes in there. And I haven't seen too many here that live in that neighborhood complaining against it. So I would really like to see you commissioners give consideration to approving the plans that she's proposed here, because I think she would be good for the neighborhood, and I'm certainly going to continue to be a customer there.
Good evening. My name is Janetta DeLugo-Kecki, and I live off of Knotty Pine Lane. I live off of Perth Road, close to the property. And I just want to thank Sarah Heritaisi for all the years of service that she's done for this this county. Thank you for that. I've opposed to the rezoning of this property, vehemently opposed to this property. I've been in this county 20 years now. I'm not a newbie. I've kind of seen what's going on in here. And I'm against this for a couple reasons. One of them is the property is located in the Catawba Lake Norman WS4PA water supply watershed. It's a protected water area, which allows for only 24% impervious coverage. This would increase that enormously. My second and biggest complaint with this is that it will not comply with the local land use plans for this area. Current land use plans call for the area of Perth Road between Highway 150 and Autumn Leaf Road in Troutman to continue the pattern of low density residential uses, keeping all commercial zoning off this area of Perth Road. This Perth Road study was adopted in January 2008 of this year by you, the Iredell County Board of Commissioners. This area, along with others, was considered for future commercial land uses. However, it was decided that due to the close proximity of commercial nodes in Mooresville and Troutman, that no additional commercial areas were needed along this corridor. No additional commercial properties. The plan specifically recommended that petitions for non-residential rezoning of properties within the county's jurisdiction will not be supported by the planning staff, and that existing legal non-conforming businesses should be allowed to remain, although rezoning is not recommended. The rezoning of this property does not fit into the future land use plans of the town of Mooresville either, since their plans call for low density residential development for this area. This property is owned by Odell Stamey. It's owned by the same person. His daughter here is the registered agent for this property. Perth Landscaping has had a problem since the first day it opened with adhering to plans that were approved for that business in that location by the planning board. They've created all their own problems. If they had just stuck to the original plans that they were approved, they wouldn't be having all these problems with the trucks and the tractors and everything else. Right now, they're in in violation. They have mulch piled up on the south side of the property that's for sale. They're not supposed to have mulch on that side of the property for sale. They've also had mulch over there. It's supposed to be spread, but it's been there a couple weeks or maybe about a week. It's still not spread. As we know, these are the plans that we saw there are just plans. There's nothing that says that once this rezoning goes in, if a rezoning is approved, that there's anything that binds her to complete this. We verified that at the planning board meeting. There is nothing that binds her at any time to go through with these plans. It's like he said, she could put up a building with just some plastic on it. She made a comment at her meeting that basically said if we didn't go along with the rezoning that we would have to look at the place as is. Well, if she hadn't have done, if her father hadn't have done what he did to the property, it wouldn't look like he did. She's had the property for a year now. She could have done some improvement on the south side, on that side of the property, and she hasn't done anything. My church, Rocky Mount, had additional built on to it a couple of years ago. We had to go through all the zoning laws. We followed all of them to a T. We didn't break any of them. Lake Norman High School just added some additional parking. Same thing. They did not come after the fact and try to get rezoning to get that changes that they did to their business into compliance. They did it up front before this was done. I know we've heard from some employees that this is a great business. It supports the area, the sales tax revenue. But basically right now in this economical downturn, I'm really surprised that the business is even still there given the proximity to other. And I know she calls it a garden center, but there's a lot of those other businesses around there. There's a couple down on 150. Of course, you have your Lowe's, which is very close in Statesville there. So I'm not sure what the demographics actually look on that. There are bus stops in that area right there, one at Perth and Knotty Pine, and one that goes down into Honeysuckle. There's one actually at Perth and Knotty Pine right now with the kids. The planning board has voted twice on this now, once in June of 2006, and that vote was 10-0, and they just recently voted in October 11-0 against the rezoning of this property. I just want to say that when you do a study, my son was, 15-year-old son was at the planning board meeting, and he was sitting there and he goes, Mama, why are we even looking at trying to get this business into compliance? Didn't they have a big study that they did? Didn't that mean anything, that the paper they wrote it? Was it just a waste of their time to do that?
Becky, I'm sorry your time is about up. If you could please wind it up.
Okay, and I told him, no, Corey, these things are done for a reason. There's a study done. They did look at the planning on the road here and that, so hopefully that they will follow their own recommendations. And in this case, that recommendation is to do what you said, and that's to keep commercial business off of that road. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Van Stamey. I'm a resident of Iredell County for 23 years, 24 in row in before that. I happen to be Robbie's brother and Odell Stamey's son. Certainly followed this thing from the beginning. I noticed an interesting dynamic at the planning meeting that has to do with the land use plan. And obviously, for those people that are on the planning board or the staff, The land use plan makes sense, and when you're a part of that staff and that plan, I understand why you vote something like this down, because, you know, otherwise you're contradicting yourself. So it's an interesting dynamic, but I believe that if anybody on that planning board and the staff took off their planning board hat and spoke to this project as just a citizen of Iredell County, they would say, do it. Because to me, you know, it's a no-brainer. You look at the property the way it is now, and you look at what Robbie's going to do to the property, and in spite of the vehement opposition, the fact is it's going to improve their property, which, by the way, my dad developed that years and years ago. Secondly, I've seen my sister over the years grow businesses, and back to my father for that matter, you couldn't fill this room with the people he's employed in his 73 years. But I saw her grow a business in Charlotte, North Carolina for 20 years. It was sold. It's doing the same thing now it was doing 10 years ago when she sold it, and the owners are very happy they bought it from her. So you won't see anything in my sister's track record that suggests the negative things that are being said about what she may or may not do with the property. They're trying to create some kind of conspiracy theory, and it's just not there. And, you know, although the opposition are, you know, intellectual people, and I'm sure they're great folks, unfortunately, they speak, many of the things that they're telling you just come from ignorance. You know, my sister was in Florida. My parents wanted her home. She wanted to be home. She's got a great son who happens to be my nephew. He's got kids that are grandkids now. And so as a part of that, my dad gave her this business and the property. And it came with debt. So I don't want you to think she got some big gift. She's earned it. Don't misunderstand me. But to say that she don't own it or that she's in some kind of conspiracy to get it rezoned so my dad can come in and be some land czar is ridiculous. He's, you know, moving to the country, 73 years old. My mom's 71, and they're the greatest people on earth. And that I stand by that. So, and then there was one other point, and darn it, I can't remember what it was, but the bottom line is I think it's a no-brainer, and I hope you guys vote in favor of it, and God bless you.
My name is Ronnie Froyer, and Mr. Robertson, just a few minutes back, you asked Ms. Robbi Grayson about the beautification from the corner on the north side all the way down to Knotty Pine Lane. Did she beautify that? Well, yes and no. Half and half. Now, I'd live directly behind two trailers, a bunch of piled mulch that had just been brought in within the past 10 days. This stuff, they're using property that is not to be used and was statute as so right here 2 years ago. Now, 5 years ago, when the trees were all cut down by Mr. Stanley, and pictures show where stuff was buried, they shouldn't have been buried. Nothing was ever enforced on it, even though I have the pictures. Yes, I'm the bird that took them. Nobody ever thought twice about saying a word to me. Now, I can set in my front yard in the summertime, if I want to get eat up by mosquitoes because of water holes that are made there and nothing's done about it. Now, the front side, yeah, it's beautiful. Come up, sit in my front yard, sit on my porch, tell me what a beautiful view you see, then I'll show you some pictures of the before and the pictures of the after. Then you make the decision. You wouldn't want to live that way. Everybody holler about the taxes and such, the big revenue growing. Well, the thing of it is, yep, taxes went up. My property value went way down, and I do mean down. Right now, I have been quoted a price of less than $70,000 for 2 acres. I paid $8,500 just to have a hole put in the ground so I could have water. But now we're talking about the watershed. Nobody cares about the watershed. What are you going to do when you ain't got nothing to drink? That's all I've got to say. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Lewis Barton. I'm a citizen of Ardell County. I live on Bullfinch Road, which is off of Fern Hill. I'm a customer of the Garden Center. I've enjoyed it since Robbie's taken over. She's made a lot of improvements. She's cleaned the place up. She's got it looking great. from what I can see from her plans, she's going to make improvements for the neighborhood and improve the aesthetics and safety. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Norma Saunders. I am in real estate in the Lake Norman area, and I am a customer of the Garden Center, and I'm here in support of Robbi Grayson. The rezoning of the Perth landscaping is a need in the Lake Norman area and will be an asset because of the specialized inventory and the personalized customer service that you cannot find anywhere else in the area. And Robbi deserves to be able to utilize her property and grow her business. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Tripp Reed. I am Robbie's son, and I have the great benefit of being able to grow up with her and know that everything she has tackled and throughout her life, she's never done it secondhand. She's always done it firsthand and made a valiant effort doing it the right way and the correct way. Also, I'm a landowner in Rowan County, a neighboring county of Iredell County. I grew up in Iredell County as well as a co-owner in a business in Cabarrus County. I do not see any reason why the board would not approve any request such as in front of them tonight, simply because of the improvements that would definitely be done to this area, as well as having a wonderful small business for Iredell County. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Scott Eckholt, and I'm resident down Fern Hill on Bullfinch Road. I'm also Robbi Grayson's banker, and I would appreciate the approval tonight. other than Robbi Grayson, I have as much to gain from this approval as anybody. I can confirm whether you want to call her a resident or registered agent or not. She makes the payments on this property. She makes my loan payments each month. She's a good business owner. I've been very impressed with Miss Grayson over the last year and a half that I've had dealings with her. I've been coming to this area on Perth Road for over 20 years down Fern Hill, and I can only say that in the last 2 years, 3 years, whatever you want to call it, there's been improvements to this property. Maybe not some that were viewed in very high regard, but in the last year and a half that Robbi Grayson has been there, there's obviously been improvement. She's trying to make things look better, and if you can think back to prior to Miss Grayson coming there and establishing the Lake Norman Garden Center, it wasn't as nice as it is now. Do more things need to be done to make more people happy? I'm sure they do, but I think that if you look back at the just under 18 months that Robbi has been there, it is her effort and her intention to beautify the area. It's not her intention to ignore the other landowners that are in her backyard and only take care of what is on the front side of the street. I talk with Robbi on a regular basis. We have meetings about what the needs are going to be when this plan is approved. And, you know, what she has presented to you tonight, she's got cost figures. She knows what her budgets are going to be. She's not looking to put up a building and staple plastic to it. She wants the best for her property and for this business so that it can be sustaining long term. Thank you.
Are there no more cousins that want to speak?
I want to know who the guy was that got the truck stuck.
Is there anyone else in the audience wishing to speak regarding this matter tonight? If not, I will close this part of public hearing. And can you ask additional questions? You want to ask additional questions? Sure you can. But you need to question. Move along.
Yeah, go ahead.
Ms. Grayson. How long do you anticipate these improvements you are planning to take place for they're implemented?
How long would it take to do it once the work got started? I mean, the biggest part of it's going to be the excavation and putting the concrete pad down for the greenhouse and the road and that. The arboretum and the screening is just a planting process. I have not had this designed yet, primarily because of the cost. I've spent an enormous amount of money on architects, so we are ready, providing we get your approval, to start. Chuck McCurdy and I have been working to design the arboretum and the buffered areas. They're obviously going to be attractive, like a garden center should be, so you can come and get ideas, but providing the funding and everything in place. But it is my understanding that I have to be started within 18 months with this process, if I'm not incorrect, with the conditional zoning. In addition to doing what I propose, that's one of the conditions, that it remain a garden center, that's one of the conditions in my proposal, and that I must begin the work within 18 months. I'd love to say I'm going to have it, you know, spring. That's my intention, but with the current lending environment, I can't guarantee that.
Now, are you saying the proposals that you've made, Ron, you help me on this, are part of the conditions?
Primarily, the everything associated with the site plan, those are all tied to the request as conditions. Yes, the hours of deliveries, we really can't enforce that. You know, we're not quite as bad as it seems on our enforcement, but that's a very difficult condition to actually enforce. But mainly, the biggest conditions that she's been talking about are part of the site plan.
That includes the road, the arboretum, the greenhouse, even though you can't, the materials in the greenhouse are not included.
Correct.
But all the things in this plan are part of the conditional use, and you have 18 months to complete it. And you're not going to come back in 24 months from now and not be started, are you?
Not complete it. You have 18 months to begin.
Yeah, there's a provision in that in the conditional zoning that we included when we put this together was you have to begin a project within 18 months. Otherwise, we'll bring it back or reassess it and decide whether or not it was actually a good decision to put the zoning in place.
It's been strung out for 10 years.
Right. That's the whole intent. If someone doesn't start within that amount of time and it doesn't appear they're going to, we can bring that back to you and you can decide, you know, yay or nay, let's keep it or not.
But there's no end to it.
No, there's no end.
It can start it and put the road in 18 months and 5 years from now, the arboretum may not be built. Is that what you're saying?
That's correct. As long as you start it within 18 months, we're out. We just wanted to know from the county level that once we make these decisions that they actually begin.
Okay, if she sells this property, it's been stated, could it be turned into, what could the use be at that point?
This is what we're looking at.
Convenience store then.
Exactly. It's got to be, the beauty of the conditional district over what we used to have is that you're tied to this plan. Now, there's a 10% rule that if there's a 10% change, then you know, I can approve that. If it's more than 10%, if Ms. Grayson wants to, you know, build another building here, got to come back through the same exact process. But otherwise, tied to this plan.
Well, I guess I go back to the point I'm trying to make. You know, a lot of the evidence that supports what you're wanting has to do with the improvements you're making. And I think it's weigh heavily with this board. If these improvements are not made, then I guess my decision would be based on trust that you're going to make these improvements over not a long length of time, but something in the immediate future.
My blue sky is to have it done by this spring. Obviously, my biggest reason, I mean, as my brother once said, money doesn't grow on my trees that I sell. And my biggest reason for the improvement from a business standpoint is the spoilage I have, is the amount of plant material that we lose due to inclement weather, due to not being properly irrigated, and in my bottom line, you know, another way of making money, saving money, and not to have those losses. So it's the kind of project that I don't see how you do it in piecemeals. My goal is to come in and do it all. But my blue sky, again, providing the financial climate is such that I can work out everything at this point, is to try to get it in and done by spring so that I can have hopefully a prosperous spring and moving forward. But I don't want to piecemeal this.
You, Mr. Williams asked two of my questions. So,
you want to address Ms. Grace?
Yeah, no, actually, Ron Smith can get it. Okay, so as we understand it, what makes it conditional is that these are the conditions by which we approve it. Correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so we've got a neighbor who lives behind this site who said that it's unsightly, and part of this plan has her planting some barrier foliage and stuff. So. Shrubs or trees or whatever, it just says, you know, screening vegetation. So when we approve, if we're to approve this, then we're approving it contingent that she provides some screening. That's part of the conditions. Is that a correct statement?
Yes, sir. And some of that's actually already there, if I'm not mistaken. Yeah. But okay. Yes.
All right. And then also in your report to us, it says that if we rezone this, the words are, although the applicant has not requested it, utilizing the high-density option would allow up to 70% impervious coverage in the area. Now, according to her plans, she's trying to recover just about all the water off the site. I mean, if it rains 2 inches in a half an hour, you're toast. But if you get normal rainfall, it sounds like the intent of the watershed is going to be met. If for some reason she were to have this change of heart, which would probably coincide with buying rolls of plastic, would she have to come to some other body and request? Because it says, although the applicant has not requested it, would she need permission to put down 70% impervious surface?
Yes, she would. She would come through this board for a high density option to go up to 70%.
Is she requesting that?
No, not at this time.
Thank you very much. I'm done.
Okay. Any other questions? Mr. Smith, do you have anything else?
I'd just like to clear up one thing. In the original, there was some enforcement that went on that thing, contrary, because I was involved in some of it, Mr. Smith, and this was in your absence. And me and Stackleather went down there and told them one time they were going to have to tear the back off their building. And that was in the process when they'd already petitioned rezoning. And if it makes me a bad guy, then I'm a bad guy. I'm sympathetic to a business owner. I said, man, let's don't make the man tear the back off his building until we figure out what we're going to do. And Ben's a good inspector, and he's a good guy, and he stays after it. But he can talk mean to people when he needs to, and he roughed them up pretty good. That's Mr. Stamey. Now, they made some mistakes, but I do know firsthand there was this notion that there was no enforcement going on. That's just not accurate, because I was directly involved in some of it. I'd just like to clear that up.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. Any other questions from the board? Okay, Mr. Smith, we'll finish with thank you. At this time, I would close the public hearing. I'd be glad to entertain a motion.
Mr. Chairman, I'll make a motion, two-part motion. First is the motion to amend the Iredell County Land Use Plan.
Okay.
Do we have to vote on them separate? Yep. Whoop.
Yep. All in favor of amending the Iredell County Land Use Plan, please say aye.
Aye.
Second motion is the motion to approve the zoning map amendment and to make a finding that the approval is consistent with the adopted Iredell County Land Use Plan and that said approval is reasonable and in the public interest due to its consistency with the Iredell County Land Use Plan. As a result, said approval furthers the goals and objectives of the Iredell County Land Use Plan.
Heard that motion. Are there any questions?
All in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Ayes have it. Ms. Smith.
The second item that I have for you tonight is a requested zoning ordinance amendment. This was submitted to us by Tasha Hayden. This has actually gone through a couple of iterations through the planning board. But the request is to change the way we look at family daycare facilities. Basically, to boil this down, right now we allow up to five children in a family daycare, essentially in a house in any district that we have, any residential district that we have. What Ms. Hayden is requesting is that we allow that to go up to eight kids in the same districts, and essentially that's the only change. The proposed change going up to eight mirrors the state's, which the state is the secondary approving body after they come through us. They go to the state to get their final approval. So what we're essentially doing is bringing our regulations in line with what is allowed by the state of North Carolina, and also consequently is used by the town of Mooresville, the city of Statesville, and some of our surrounding counties. We really beat this thing to death with the planning board. There were some issues that I included in your packet as far as the number of overall children and parking and things of that nature. But the staff is comfortable with the request. We put a lot of reliance on the state to enforce and enforce rules that we really don't know how or have the expertise to enforce, and therefore we would recommend approval of the request. It was also given a favorable recommendation from the planning board as well, but it was by a vote of 5-4. And I think there might be some representatives here that may want to talk. Maybe not, but I'd be glad to try and answer any questions that you have.
You have any questions for Ms. Smith? Thank you, Ms. Smith.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else in the audience wishing to speak in regards to this matter?
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. My name is Rita Dula, and I am an owner-operator of Safe and Sound Family Child Care Home. I am located at 919 Moxville Highway between Bell Farm Road and New Salem Road. Right now, with the zoning being the way it is, I'm allowed to have five children and provide care for five children and five families. As Mooresville City and Statesville City, they are allowed to provide care for eight children. If the ordinance is approved or amended, I would be able to provide care for three more children, and perhaps I could add before care and after care, before and after school care, to what I provide for the families, and also I would be able to provide summer care. And I have adequate space, I have a quality child care, and I would just like for it to be passed that we, some of us that are out of the city limits, would be able to provide care for eight children. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Dula. Anyone else wishing to speak?
Hello, I'm Tasha Hayden. I am the one who has submitted the recommendation that the zoning be changed for a couple of reasons. When I opened up my family home 2 years ago, it wasn't a really big concern to me because I was just concerned about getting the five children. I've had to turn down parents, you know, who have come to me for child care. I have parents who have school-age children that I have been unable to keep, you know, so therefore the service I can provide to them, to those families, I haven't been able to do. So I'm just simply requesting that you just go with what the state's recommendations are, you know, that we can have those eight. And with the current economic situation that we're in, for instance, this past summer, I had five children before the summer. Three of them went out of my care, because they were starting school, parents didn't need summer care. But if I would have been able to have those school-age children beforehand, that would have kept the five, you know, and it wouldn't have put me down to two children for the summer, losing all that income. I would have still been up to five. So it would have made a great impact. Instead, we kind of suffered a little bit this summer. But anyway, I just want to maintain the quality of child care that I provide. I take pride in the quality of child care that I do provide, and I need to be able to have that financial income as well to continue to do that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Hayden. Are there any questions, Ms. Hayden?
Yes, Ms. Hayden. You say you have five children.
I currently have
what
five.
Ages?
I have a three-month-old. I have two children that will be turning two within the next month, and I have two children that will be turning three within the next couple of months.
And what kind of assistance do you have? Do you take care of these by yourself?
Yes, I do. I've worked in child care for 10 years. At one given time, I took care of five infants in a classroom all by myself. At one time, I took care of 10 three-year-olds by myself. I am also a mother of three, and two of my kids are in high school. I have a middle school age child as well.
So you don't have, you have one that you'll be caring for at home? I'm sorry.
My own children?
Yes.
No, all my children are middle school and higher. Thank you.
Oh, have mercy. That woman's got the patience of Job.
Absolutely.
I was wondering if we're supposed to give her a medal or something.
Hello, I'm Jennifer Griffith. I'm Director of Quality Support Services with the Iredell County Partnership for Young Children. And I'm director of a team that goes out into the family child care homes and the child care centers and helps maintain the quality that we establish with these centers and homes through the Division of Child Development and also through the Health Department Environmental Services. And so we're constantly working with the family child care home providers and the centers to ensure that they are meeting the quality and the licensing standards that need to be met for our county and for the state. I'm wondering if y'all had any questions on my end for the technical assistance that we provide.
You feel comfortable with what they're asking, ma'am?
Yes, right now we have about 51 homes. 40 of those homes currently are meeting the state guidelines. We have 10 homes right now that this zoning ordinance would affect. And so far, you know, we've never had any issues or anything with the 8 children in the home. So right now this is affecting 10 out of the 50. Jennifer. Everyone else has already switched to the state standards.
Jennifer, could you explain to me how those 40 are in compliance and the 10 are not?
I think, well, we've been to the Mooresville City and gotten the zoning change to the 8. We've been to the City of Statesville meetings and gotten it passed for the zoning to change to 8. So that's now why we're coming to the Iredell County. Just because one of the things we'd like to do is have everyone meet the state standards and the economic impact also on the family child care home providers. And the school age clientele of children are really the three that are in question that we want to add so they can provide care for school age children after school. And that's a big need right now, is the care for the school age children. And this will allow them to care for three more school age children. And if the ratios for family child care homes are much lower than the ratios in child care centers, one staff can be with 12 to 24 children by themselves in a child care center. That's a little tricky.
Thank you, Mr. Griffin.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, Department of Social Services approves of this request, as it would put all the family daycare homes in Iredell County on the same page, and it would give us additional daycare slots for families.
Thank you, Ms. Wong.
Any additional questions? Anyone? Okay. If not, close this segment of the public hearing. Entertain a motion.
Mr. Chairman, I...
Go ahead.
Go ahead. Mr. Chairman, I approve, move, we approve the request.
Okay. Any questions regarding that motion? Not all in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed? Okay, ayes have it. Okay. Now I move to Mr. Mashman. Administrative matters.
Mr. Chair, under administrative matters, I'm going to do the consent agenda items first, and that begins with item number B, approval of a 3-year Bell South service agreement extension on the current contract, approval of budget amendment number 21 for the acceptance of an urban area security initiative grant that has provided a 2008 Chevrolet 3500 heavy-duty pickup for emergency management. Item D is approval of an agreement allowing Iredell Landfill Gas, LLC, and Iredell Transmission, LLC, to merge together. Both are owned by DTE Biomass Energy. This is the company that at the landfill that burns the methane there and generates electricity. Item E is approval of budget amendment number 22 for the recognition of $164,405 in federal equity sharing funds and for the purchase of 50 80 megahertz radios for the Sheriff's Department. Item F is request for approval or approval of budget amendment number 23 in the amount of $28,108 for wayside volunteer fire department repairs. Item G is approval of budget amendment number 24 in the amount of $250,000 for the construction of a central volunteer fire department substation to be located near the intersection of Lenny Mills Road and Barker's Grove Road. Item H is approval of the Firefighters Relief Fund Board of Trustees. Item I is approval of a request from the Human Resources Department for adoption of the following items effective December the 1st of 2008. The first is a shared leave policy, and second is policy revisions of the personnel ordinance to the drug and alcohol testing policy and to the vehicle operations policy. Item J is approval to allow the staff to negotiate in a design service contract with Daggett and Grigg Architects for the proposed Iredell County Animal Control Facility. Item K is approval of a request for the establishment of a new income maintenance caseworker 3 position for the Health Net program. This would be in the Department of Social Services. Item L is approval of request from DSS for the recognition of $25,200 in funding for Work First Functional Assessment. And then under item M, the approval of the minutes of October the 21st, retreat, as well as the briefing and regular minutes, November the 3rd, special meeting, and November the 10th, continuation of the special meeting. Item N is to appropriate from contingency up to $70,000 to be used for additional repairs to the parking lot at the tax administration office. That would be budget amendment number 25. Those are the consent agenda items, Mr. Chair.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Mashman. You heard the consent agenda. Do we have a motion to accept the consent agenda?
Move for approval, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Ms. Tice. Any questions regarding the consent agenda or the motion? All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed, likewise.
Mr. Chair, item A is request to approve the October 2008 refunds and releases. Mr. Bill Doolittle is here from the Tax Administrator's Office to present this item.
Mr. Chairman, I'm going to need to excuse myself from this vote. I've got a used trailer that appears on the release report, so I'd like to be excused from this vote.
Okay.
Okay, you have a motion to excuse Mr.
Robertson. Mr. Chairman, I make a motion that we excuse Mr. Robertson from this matter.
Okay, all in favor of the motion, please say aye.
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 Okay, excuse from the vote. Mr. Dulo, go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman and Commissioners. I'd like to submit the refunds and releases for October and respectfully request that they be approved.
Okay, do I have a motion?
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. Any questions regarding the motion?
Mr. Doolittle been sitting here all that time over $3.83. You get an extra piece of pie at the Christmas dinner, Mr. Doolittle.
All in favor of the motion, please say aye.
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 Thank you, Mr. Doolittle.
And you can expect your check in 30 days.
Announcement of vacancies occurring on boards and commissions. Mooresville Planning Board, ETJ, one announcement. Appointments to boards and commissions. Adult Care Home Community Advisory Committee, 4 points.
Move to table, Mr. Chairman.
Motion to table. All in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed. State for Planning Board, ETJ, one appointment.
Motion to table, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Johnson. Motion to table. All in favor of the motion, please say aye.
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 Excuse me. Nursing Home Advisory Committee, 5 appointments.
Mr. Chairman, I'd nominate Ms. Elsie Carter.
Okay. Any additional nominees?
Mr. Chairman, I would nominate Brenda Spies.
Okay. Have any additional? All in favor of the two motions, please say aye.
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 Aye. Those opposed. Criminal Justice Partnership Program Committee, 1 appointment.
Motion to table.
Okay, motion to table. All in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Animal Grievances Committee, 1 appointment.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to nominate Sidney Weisman.
Okay, Weisman. Any additional nominees? All in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Crossroads Behavioral Health Care, 2 appointments.
Mr. Chairman, it is my honor to nominate Dinah Daniels and the Honorable Godfrey Williams.
Thank you, Mr. Robertson. All in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Those opposed. Okay, unfinished business. Do we have any? Okay. Public comment period. We do have one speaker. Mr. Nixon. Come up, sir.
Mr. Chair, Honorable Board of Commissioners, I'll be very brief. The hour is late. I'm here to vocalize something you do not hear very often, and that's a compliment. I want to thank the county manager as his retirement approaches for his dedicated service to the county, and my appreciation as a taxpayer to him. And to a young lady on your board that has served for a number of years, Ms. Sarah Hare-Tice, I personally want to thank you for your dedicated service to Ardale County, your friendship and your support to my family, and your influence and seat is going to be very difficult to fill. They may fill your seat, but it's going to take 4 commissioners to fill your shoes. God bless you and thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Nixon.
Thank you for your kind remarks, Tom. I appreciate it. Mr. Chairman, if I may, at this time, I'd like to take the opportunity to thank the citizens of Ardle County for electing me to serve as your county commissioner these past 18 years. It's certainly been a pleasure for me, and I appreciate so much the faith and confidence that the citizens of Ardle County has shown me during these 18 years. I'd just like to repeat what Tom Nixon said about our county manager, Joel Mashburn. He has certainly
led this county professionally with great integrity and respect from all the citizens of the county. And when he leaves the 1st of February, he's certainly going to be missed. And I don't envy the commissioners that will be seated the first Monday in December of the job that they will have to replace Mr. Mashburn as the county manager. The county staff here in Ardle County is second to none in the state of North Carolina. Of course, Mr. Mashburn, as our leader, has always done an outstanding job. Susan Blumenstein, our finance officer, is the best in the state. She repeatedly, year after year after year, receives the certification of excellence provided by the state of North Carolina. And what in the world would we do without Jean Moore to keep the commissioner straight, our clerk to the board? She writes the minutes with perfection. She keeps our appointments before us all the time, and she's always willing to help any way that she can. And of course, Bill Pope has been here for the 18 years that I have served, and at times he has had his hands full to keep us out of trouble. So I would certainly like to thank Mr. Pope for his contributions. He's a great attorney, and he certainly has served us well. And last but not least, I would like to thank my fellow commissioners for the bonds that we've formed over the years. We are pretty much like a family. We don't always agree on the issues, but we have a lot of respect for each other and their right to their own opinion. Each commissioner is very unique in a special way. Each commissioner is the public's choice. So everyone that is elected to this board, I think, deserves a lot of honor. And again, I won't ramble on any longer, but thanks to everyone. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Ms. Dice, and we appreciate your words.
Thank you.
We will miss you. The only bright side we have with you and Mr. Mashburn leaving in the next 6 months is we get to keep Ms. Moore and Ms. Blumenstein and our attorney. So
absolutely.
Hopefully we can stay out of trouble so we can get another leader down here. But we do appreciate you and all you've done for the county and all you've done for us.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, while we have the camera rolling, I would like to say one thing or a couple of things about Ms. Tice. My first recollection of Ms. Tice being chairman, I'd been on the board about 2 weeks, and it was the Lowe's rezoning up on, what's the name of the road up there, sir?
The North Ardle.
Yeah.
Get the road.
Can't remember the name of the road. And I got to the meeting that night, and my stomach was tied in a knot, and we were sitting at the supper table. They always give us something good to eat, and I was sitting there, and I couldn't eat. My stomach was tied in a knot, and I looked over across the table, and Sarah was a-woofing down her supper, and she looked over at me and said, "You better eat up, Steve. It's going to be a long night." And she just kept eating. But I said, well, maybe with experience I will have that temperament. And over time you get it where people can say pretty much anything about you and you don't have any feelings left. You just make up your mind you're going to do the right thing.
But we did have tractors and balers and a lot of farm equipment encircling the camp at the time.
One thing I always admired about Sarah, really, you could have a heated discussion with her on the telephone or even in person, but the next time you met her, she was the same old Sarah, because she put it behind her because she knew we had a job to do. And the job was bigger than the way she felt. And I always admired you, Sarah. And I know, as you said earlier, we've had our differences, but over the years I've been here, I consider you one of my very best friends, and I respect you greatly.
Well, the same here. You know, we've worked together 12 years, and we have not agreed on a lot of the issues, but we certainly have respect for each other, and when you talk about honesty and integrity, you're talking about Steve Johnson. If he gives you his word that he's going to support a project, then you can take it to the bank. So, Steve, it's been my pleasure.
Yes, ma'am.
We kind of feel like family here. I know Godfrey and I worked on a project when he was vice chair of the Arles States School Board, and I was chairman of the county board. We were looking for property for the Lake Norman High School, and we had received a price from the developer, but when he found out that Arles Statesville Schools was interested, then he increased the price. Well, Godfrey and I went to work, and we very gently encouraged him to to sell it to us for what he had promised, and so I believe we prevailed in that one, God, didn't we?
Yeah, I'd like to say, you know, my experience with the godmother of Iredell County goes back to days before I was a commissioner in the days of the school board, because I'd known Sarah when she ran for election the first time. I don't know if she remembers me or not, but you know, I found Sarah even those times, and of course everybody knows that school boards and commissioners are natural adversaries, and it's intended that way because as a way of kind of dividing up the government to where there's not a rubber stamp. And I learned that real soon when I went on the board and some of the issues that came along in the early 90s. I always found Sarah was a person that I could talk to as a member of the school board. And it's like it was said before, when Sarah gave her word, that was her word. She wouldn't vary from that. You could always depend on it. Now, getting her to agree sometimes was not that easy, but once she set her mind to it, there was no change. And we've enjoyed a relationship going back till 92. And I've always admired Sarah for the way she's always stood up for the county, especially for her area of the county. And I think that she's going to be remembered in this county for a long, long time.
You know, everybody keeps saying all this stuff about it's like a family. And I'm the new kid on the block, I guess, at least for another week or so. And I will tell you that Mama does not mind taking you out to the woodshed. And and if you notice, everybody's danced around that, but I'll say it. Mama will take you to the woodshed. But the thing that I'll remember the most is not necessarily us sitting in this chamber. It's usually in the parades I drive, Sarah. So anyway, it looks like we might get one. I'll get one more opportunity to drive Sarah around in a parade. So looking forward to that.
Look forward to that.
As far as gentle persuasion, it is always persuasive. It's not always gentle.
Well, thank you very much. Yes, I appreciate it.
Okay. Mr. Chair, may I say something?
Yes, sir.
I really wasn't prepared for this tonight. And we do have one more meeting, I don't forget.
Mm-hmm. A short one.
But Mrs. Tice's put several accolades on her work with me, and talking about my success and so forth has been a manager, and I appreciate that. But I can say this, any person sitting in this position here can never be a success if they don't have the support of the people sitting over there in those chairs, and in particularly the support of the chairman. And over the years that I've been here, I've been very blessed to be working with people that it's not been difficult for me to be successful working with them. And I want to say particularly to Mrs. Tice that that's certainly the case with her. She's many times said that I have been the reason that she's been successful, but I know better than that, because I know, working as closely with her as I have, the type of person that she really is, and the devotion and dedication that she's had to this county and to all the county, and I just I've enjoyed working with you. I'm going to miss working with you. There are some things that we've been through that I'm not going to miss, but certainly working with you is going to be one of the things that I will miss the most.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. We'll move on to new business. Any new business? County Manager's Report.
Mr. Chair, the only thing I've got is the activities report, which you should have a copy of that placed before you.
Okay. And I'll make a motion that we go into closed session under one item, legal, GS-143-318.11, Section A3, GS-143-318.11A6, personnel. That is the motion. Okay.
Can you imagine what life in North Carolina would be like if there were no county governments? Probably not. Because if you're like most people, you find it difficult to describe what your county government does for its citizens. The fact is, every time you go to a public school, or take a walk in a county park, or check out a book from the county library, or even eat in a restaurant, your county is working to provide programs and services that enhance our quality of life, protect us, and prepare us for the future. Counties create opportunity for coming generations by building and maintaining our public school facilities. Besides the money spent for buildings and grounds, counties put more than $2 billion each year into North Carolina's public school system. These funds are used to provide salary supplements to attract and retain top caliber teachers and hire additional classroom personnel to provide a better educational opportunity for our children. Counties enrich our lives by providing libraries that offer more than just books to read. Public libraries offer access to computers and the internet, educational programs for young children, as well as cultural activities, movie screenings, and community events. The great outdoors wouldn't be quite so great if it weren't for county efforts to protect farmland, preserve open space, and create and maintain parks and recreation facilities. County governments care for our environment in other ways too. On average, each North Carolinian generates 5.6 pounds of trash per day, creating 350 million tons of trash a week. Counties operate landfills to safely dispose of our waste so that it doesn't cause environmental problems, while recycling programs help reduce waste in landfills. Counties are also taking on an increasing role in providing clean water and wastewater treatment services to meet the needs of our growing population. County parks and recreation programs have something for absolutely everyone. From toddlers to seniors, sewing to swimming, nature classes to cooking classes, as well as athletic leagues and summer camps. A county government's responsibilities are not all fun and games. Counties also ensure our well-being so that we live in communities that are safe and secure. County sheriffs protect and preserve the peace, and counties also provide emergency medical response services and fund volunteer fire departments to watch over our health and safety. Many of the ways counties protect our citizens are harder to see, but they are no less vital and important. When you walk into a building or home, county inspectors have verified that the building meets safety codes. When you walk into a restaurant, you know what you're getting, because county inspectors give sanitation grades to restaurants to reduce unsanitary practices and foodborne diseases. Health departments supply flu shots and other medical services for needy citizens, help control communicable diseases, and make available health education resources. These and other services are becoming even more necessary. By the year 2030, North Carolina is projected to grow from 9 million to 12 million people. The Census Bureau estimates we will be the seventh largest state in the nation. To accommodate this growth, counties will have to build at least 500 new schools in the next 20 years, or one new school every 2 weeks. Our growing population will tax our water supply and other natural resources, so county governments are already planning for tomorrow and taking the necessary steps to meet the challenges we will all face. All told, it's a pretty full day of work for your county government, every day. But it doesn't stop there. County government, enhancing the quality of our lives and protecting our well-being today, while improving the future for all of North Carolina.
why would our, this was the first time we could have used our
and clocks. It didn't work. I don't know why it didn't work, Larry.
I don't know. It's like it was stuck or something.
Not only did we need the clock, we needed a buzzer.
Remind you.
Okay, the report as a result of our meeting. I entertain a motion for adjournment.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. All in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Ayes have it.
I'm parked.
I got your dirty old signs in the back of my car.